So what exactly is the world going to be like in the year 2067? Let's talk to filmmaker Seth Larney and find out. Welcome to the Film Threat Podcast. I am Chris Gore. I am happy to talk to you today about another indie sci-fi movie that I think you must see. I'm a huge fan of independent science fiction, as you well know, if you're a listener or watcher to this show. And I'm fortunate to get to see these movies. I'm very pleased to share them with you. I have the director here all the way from Australia. Is that right, Seth Larney?
That's right, man. I'm in Sydney, Australia.
Oh, that's awesome. Cool. Well, so you're actually time traveling in a sense already, because you're...
Yeah. I think I'm in yesterday, I think. Yeah,
you are. what I find fascinating about this movie, I mean, there's a time travel element. I don't want to ruin too much about the story. You can find the trailer on YouTube for 2067. But it does have a very clever, first of all, environmental element, so that they're you know, also a saving humanity element. In a way, it kind of felt like the reverse of Terminator, right? In the sense of going into the future to save the past, which I thought was really clever. Plus, a production design I thought was really remarkable. I mean, I don't know what kind of budget you were working with, but those scenes of Earth in the quote present day, which is our distant future, actually, were pretty amazing. How did you pull something like this together on such a low budget?
I try really hard to make those restrictions with budget work in your favor as a storyteller, if you know what I mean. So I have a visual effects background. I was a visual effects supervisor for some time. I think for this film, it works really well, is have these moments of scale where you might only show the scale of the city for one shot or two shots. And so the audience has this big emotional impact, right, of feeling the world that's out there for the character. But then in the next scene, you can bring that character into a small space and do the drama, because really at the core, this film is really just about relationships. And the audience remembers emotionally that scale. And I feel like they take that with them through the movie, that you don't have to show those big visual effects shots over and over and over again, right? Do it once, do it really well, set the tone, move on. And then the film really lives in the drama and the intimate spaces. Yeah.
Well, it has like a feel of like $100 million, like big budget science fiction. And I'm pretty sure you probably weren't working with $100 million, but it really has a big feel to it.
Thanks so much. I really appreciate that. It's really nice to hear that. We are, you know, a lot, many magnitudes less than that. So I'm really stoked to hear that it feels bigger than it really is. Yeah.
And yeah, you're right. Just by showing a couple shots, it looks really amazing. And then also the sound design, you kind of like check all the boxes of like a big budget thing, which is why I'm surprised. It's unfortunate theaters aren't fully open in the United States right now. I mean, that would be nice, but I feel like this movie really needs to be seen on the big screen. Another thing that really struck me was, and I want to get to the actors because I thought the cast was really incredible. But the color design, I was looking at your poster and just all this, there's really a conscious effort to make the color design of the different locations. Kind of like, I mean, George Lucas had this whole thing where it's just like, well, you have three planets in all these movies and they each have sort of a color palette. You had that color palette down. I thought, oh my God, you must have been influenced by George Lucas in some way.
Absolutely. I mean, I was, you know, lucky enough to work on Episode 3 as I think my second movie. So, you know, and Star Wars is probably like one of the biggest, if not the biggest influence on my filmmaking career when I was a kid. So yeah, absolutely. I think, again, sort of like bringing it back to story is something that I try and do, you know, at every opportunity. And so the colors in the film, like, so again, it's like that emotional shift, right? So in the first act of the movie, because we've deforested the planet and there are no trees, what we try to do is make it so that there isn't just no trees, but there's no green at all in the production design. So down to the literally minute details of the surfaces. And because we were building a world from scratch, and, you know, on the one hand, you have the task of having to build everything, but on the other hand, you have the opportunity because you can then design everything from the ground up. So it's a subconscious thing that hopefully the audience doesn't actually cerebrally notice that there's no green, but you feel it. Everything's red and blue and very dark and gritty. And so that then when the movie shifts into the second act, you're sort of like assaulted by this color, by green, that you've not felt or seen in the film before. And then you have this emotional response to that change and that shift. So, you know, again, like trying to make those sort of choices feel like they serve the story and really reflect the theme as clearly as possible and you know, grow out into all of the craft choices that you make is hopefully things that the audience feels, maybe doesn't necessarily think about.
Well, I think, I guess it doesn't surprise me that you worked on Revenge of the Sith, which, you can see that world building that you were able to do with this film, which I think was amazing. Also on the casting, I feel like you really went against type on a lot of your casting choices. And I'm spacing on the name of your lead, the lead actor.
Cody Smith McPhee. Yeah, he's incredible.
He's incredible. Like, I just feel like he was such an uncharacteristic choice. And it's so like, I mean, he has these like intense eyes and just like also what he had to deal with, like emotionally, like with family, like that all playing out across these, you know, across time, so to speak. Like, how did you find him? And then also like put together the other supporting cast.
Cody is sort of the type. Cody's an actor that I've been watching for many years, and he's the type of actor that I love. I love to work with, and I think it's partly because of those reasons that you say. Like, he really is the unassuming hero. He's somebody that I think a lot of people can relate to. I certainly relate to, and I think when I was writing the film, and as you say, those issues. The film really is about these pretty, you know, strong sort of family issues. I wanted to have this character that felt like they can't necessarily look after themselves physically. And then it really becomes about their inner strength, right? Like, the inner strength is something that you have to earn, that you have to work at, because you don't have the, you know, the big physique. It's not the classic kind of action hero sort of type movie. So that was really important for me. And also for him as well, like he's a young man that's really growing into his strength as a human being as well. And so we spoke a lot about that. This was the first role that he did, you know, as a man, I'd say, you know, just because of the length it takes to make movies. So yeah, we talked about that a lot. And also I think just on another level, like he really, from the first conversation I had with him, he understood the deep sort of like philosophical questions I was trying to ask with the movie on a really deep level. He's incredibly sort of introspective and deep human being. I always joke that he's a 1,000-year-old soul, you know, in a 22-year-old's body. So that was perfect for the character. And I really connected with him on that level. I think, and then with Ryan Kwanten plays his brother. It was a similar thing, right? Like, it was really important to me that they were quite different, because Ryan plays the big brother mentor figure who does have all of those attributes that Cody, you know, that Ethan is lacking. So in many ways, Ethan needs Ryan, Ethan needs Jude to protect him and look after him. And so then as the movie moves on and Ethan is sort of growing out from underneath this shadow in some ways, there's a real shift in the balance of power and a struggle there that I think is really interesting, because they are almost opposite sides of a coin. Yeah.
I also thought he was a great choice as a lead because it actually fits the physical world that's happening. I mean, you're living in an environment now where air is a commodity, right? Like, and yeah. I can relate to that, being in Southern California right now, where we've got wildfires here, and there are certain days where they say it's not safe to go outdoors. So the world building that you did in the beginning, where these, you know, oxygen is something that, I mean, it's life, right? I mean, it's
right.
Yeah, I mean, that just seemed to work so well. And being an unlikely hero, I think, is what made him such a perfect choice. I'm curious how audiences have responded to the film, because there are so many deeper layers to it, and especially it just feels, especially now with the way that the world is, I feel like this movie feels more relevant than ever. So I'm just curious how audiences have responded.
Yeah, well, it's quite ironic, right? And I think also a little bit bittersweet, you know, because when we started pitching the film, which was probably 10 or 15 years ago, excuse me, it was almost an abstract pitch to get people to understand that these concepts weren't very sci-fi. I'd never considered it to be a sci-fi movie. You know, it's just a drama. It's a thriller. I'm a thriller director, and it's talking about themes that I think are important. You know, sci-fi is the setting and the place, but it's not what's important about the film. And so, but you know, people would respond in a way of oxygen. How does that work? And is that really believable that the world Earth would be deforested? And you know, all these sorts of things. But now that we've made the movie and it's getting out and seeing its audience, you know, the reaction that I've been seeing from speaking to the people that have seen it has been, wow, this is so current. You know, how did you know? And the truth is, it's just something that I've cared about for a long time. And it's very bittersweet to me that, I mean, it's nice that it's current, of course it is. But it's very bittersweet that we have to, you know, that we've had the year that we've had, not just the year, I think also, but last year when we were actually finishing the visual effects shots, I was working on, there's a shot at the beginning of the movie, and not to sort of give away too much plot, but, you know, something to do with the fires and burning and this sort of like apocalypse. And I was working on this visual effects shot. I had it on one monitor. And on the second monitor on my desk, I had the government fire radar that they distribute in real time, because my father's house was being evacuated and the fires were encroaching on his house. And last year, as you probably know, in Australia, we had terrible fires, as you guys have had as well. And so I was terrified that he wasn't going to be able to be evacuated in time from his house, and watching these fires as I was doing a visual effects shot of fires burning down the world. And that was like really, you know, kind of horrific, and serendipitous, and, you know, all of those things. Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's bizarre that I feel like it's caught up, right? Like your film has caught up to the present. Here we are wearing masks, you know, because of the pandemic. But I want to thank you, Seth Larny, for being on the Film Threat podcast. Congratulations on 2067, which is it out now on like iTunes and video on demand platforms at the currently? Yeah.
It's the 2nd of October, so I think within a day or two of where you are, it's being released across the USA. So it should be in theaters. And I know that a lot of people can't get to the theaters, but if you can, you know, it really is a big screen movie. But it's also going to be released online as well on various platforms. So I'm sure you'll be able to find it. And then after that, it's going to be released worldwide over the next 6 months. It'll be in all the different territories. So, yeah.
And hopefully in the drive-in too, because I have not been missing the drive-in. Drive-ins are the
Absolutely. Well, we went to the drive-in in Sydney here just a couple of months ago. It was fantastic. Yeah.
They're so great. So thank you, Seth Larny. I also want to thank our sponsor, Storyblocks. Go to storyblocks.com/filmthread. All sorts of tools for filmmakers, including tools to do your own special effects, like Seth. Although, Seth, you know, you got legit cred with the Star Wars. I got to give you props for that. I mean, Revenge of the Sith is my favorite of the prequels. So.
Oh, great. Well, me too, but I'm a little bit biased, and I really appreciate that. I mean, I was just a passenger on those, you know, in those movies, a fly on the wall, you know, so to speak. So, yeah, it's been an honor. Been very lucky.
Awesome. Thanks a lot, man. Take care.
Thanks so much, Chris. I appreciate it, man. Thanks for having me.